she is.
Jesus, I'm so glad.
Well, good morning and welcome to Boston's by Methodist Church. It's good to see so many of you here. The weather's trying to be kind to us, which is good. Just a few housekeeping notes. If there is a fire, follow me. Obviously, you don't use the lift. But, you know, toilets downstairs. If you're really desperate, you can flip through that door, there's one through there as well. It's washing all the ministers' toilet, I'll let you use it. Door at the back, so if there's a fire or anything, just out from the back door there or the side, whichever, depending on the seat of the fire is really. But we shouldn't have one. We've got a lot of new electrics up at the moment, so you never know. You may have spotted the lovely speakers. Unfortunately, they're not joined together yet because the guy fitting them went down with COVID halfway through his job. So if you needed the loop for hearing, I'm afraid that's disconnected at the moment, so I apologise for that. So it's halfway through the system. But anyway, you haven't come here to see me. You've come to see esteemed Reverend Leslie and... or steaming, whichever. Anyway, I shall pass you over to
Leslie. Thank you, Steve, I think. Good morning. Thank you so much for coming. What on earth have you come to? I was thinking, what shall I say? What on earth have you come to? I had a sabbatical March the 23rd to nearly the end of June, which is a precious gift by the Methodist Church, for which I was very grateful. And what I want to share this morning is what's in my head. It's a bit of a brain dump of what was in my head at the end of the sabbatical. And so at one level, I think this morning is therapy for me. To be able to share that with you, you can all put your invoice in at the end for professional counselling. It's testimony. I guess I just want to be honest about. I think this is. You know when Mike Garwood used to get to the end of the show and used to say, "And this is me." I think this is going to be me trying to be as nearly fully me as I can be. What does that mean? It means that sometimes I think I'm finding myself living in a bit of a tension of what the church requires of us and expects of us, and the direction of travel of the church, and what I need to do as a district chair and a presbyter in full connection and all the rest of it, with some of what I feel on the inside, and some of that galvanized during my sabbatical. So I'm not saying I'm in a crisis. Don't misread. This has been live streamed as well. This is not Leslie in a crisis, but because when you fulfill a role, you're obligated to fulfill that role with integrity and do the best job you can. But I think I came back from sabbatical with a clearer view, personally, of my heart and longing for the Methodist Church. And sometimes I feel that some of that goes against the grain of how I feel the Methodist Church is moving, which sounds really harsh, and I'll try and soften the edges of that. So it's about me being real, and at least you know where I'm at, and maybe that's helpful. So there we are. That's what you've come to. If you'd like to leave now, then that's fine. Caveats about this morning, we will be done by one. The danger is it will be quite a lot of me just talking, I think, because I've got a lot to get through. but I will try and create space. So my aim is by 11:45, I'll have got to the end of what I've done, and we'll have then 40 minutes where we can talk. But there will be bits in between that. But I'm not going to be splitting you up into loads of small groups and all that kind of thing. So introverts, relax. This is good, okay? And we will break for coffee somewhere around 11 or a quarter past 11. And if any man of a certain age needs to go to the toilet, then just go, there's no embarrassment here, we're fine. Is that all right? Is that okay? Great. On my sabbatical form, then I said various things. One, that I wanted to look at early Methodism and what it might say to us as a church in the 21st century. And one was about music. The other was about music. I'd like to just get the chance to play the piano a bit more. And they came together a little bit for me because as I dug into some of the stuff that I was studying about early Methodism, then I kind of renewed my appreciation of some of the Wesleyan hymns. And there are various hymns in the hymn book that I rarely choose, mainly because the tune's a bit naff. So it seems to me. I hope it's not indulgent. I hope none of this is indulgent. That'd be my worst fear realised, if any of this feels like Leslie being indulgent. But I thought we would share a tune that I wrote when I was on sabbatical, which is on your handout, which is number 490 in Hymns and Psalms. It's a hymn that I don't think I've ever picked as a leader of worship. Some of you preachers will say, tut tut. I said, do people pick this hymn, Being of Beings? Okay, it was written in 1739, so you've had lots of chance, preachers, to pick it, but there we go. Isn't that interesting? But, so I'm going to go off mic and shout.
The tune that set is Tottenham, which is it's a final hymn. You never have it at the start to the end, so you put it in the middle where people put it.
I was just struck with
great words, aren't they? They're fat words. They're not like some words.
The great ones. They're great ones. Shall we pray? Heavenward our every wish aspires, for all your mercies store, the sole return your love requires, is that we ask for more. For more we ask, we open then our hearts to embrace your will. Turn and revive us, Lord, again, with all your fullness fill. Come, Holy Ghost, the Saviour's love, shed in our hearts abroad, so shall we ever live and move and be with Christ in God. Amen. I've been a Methodist before I knew I was. And some of you will share that story, I guess. So I've been a Methodist forever, and Methodism has completely shaped and dominated my life, dominated in a good way. I am Leslie Newton, who I am before you, because of the Methodist Church, in my nurture, in my family, in the opportunities I had to do all sorts of things in life. The Methodist Church has framed everything. I met my wife at Methodist Training College, who's a Methodist, obviously. The whole thing is framed, my vocation, my life, my house, my money, where I get it from. You know, the whole thing is Methodism. And I love Methodism. And I always, I think, need to be careful about my love of Methodism that isn't idolatry, because it owes me so much. But I love Methodism. And I need to say that at the outset. It is in so many ways for me the defining home in which I live is Methodism. And some of you, I guess, will be in that place too. But the thing that I guess causes me pain in saying all of that is when we face the reality of who we are as the Methodist people in this land. And whilst not wanting to say here that God owes the Methodist Church a future, that's not the right way to look at it at all, is it? If we face the reality of who we are, we're actually just honest about it for a time, we have baked in inexorable, consistent decline in the Methodist Church in this land. Numerically, the demographics are going against us, the impact that we're able to make in many ways is just not what it was, and so on. And this is not to go into a whole avalanche of a story of all of that stuff, but is it okay just to say that if we face reality, that's kind of where we're at? Great. Smaller, older, less of a dynamic presence within the communities of our land. And that's who we are as the Methodist people, the people called Methodists. And yet, I'm here because I want to say, as a phrase that is bandied around every now and again, and notably Ken Howcroft said it when he was president of a conference in 2014, God, I don't believe that God is finished with us yet. God is not finished with us yet. That's kind of why I'm here. Now, again, caveat, you know, if God wants to be finished with us and do everything through other routes, that's fine. That's God. God is God. Okay? But actually, I'm here because I don't think God is finished with us yet. That's my belief. I don't think he's finished with us yet. And this morning, in a sense, is my cri de coeur. Is that how you say it? The cry of my heart, I think that's what it is, isn't it? And I thought that's a great phrase. The cry of my heart is that I think we need to rediscover our reason for being, our confidence, our sense of mandate, our rediscover our true clothes, if you like, as the people called Methodists. I'll come back to that in a bit. So that we can play, as the people called Methodists, our distinctive charism part in the great richness of the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. That we've got a contribution to make, and I believe that. And I believe that we've got a part to play in the ongoing work of God in mission. And part of what I think was the unfolding adventure during the sabbatical was just to recognize for me afresh how that could be, and how actually what was happening in the 18th century could be for us a really incredible. incredibly hopeful template for what we could be in the 21st century, where we see, some of you have been familiar with the Fresh Expressions movement, and you see new things developing in all sorts of ways, and how the Methodist Church can really play its part in that. So I came back from sabbatical at the end of it, feeling freshly encouraged, excited, hope-filled, that with God's heart and providence, there's still a valuable contribution for the Methodist people to play in this land. And I came back and said that, and Sean, my PA, she said, "Oh, that's nice." I made me feel a bit patronised at that point. But anyway, there we are. So that's the, my creed occur, okay? That we rediscover ourselves. I'm not here to say that we need a new program or a new strategy or a new initiative. Praise the Lord. Yeah. Excellent. I thought I'd start with some easy wins. Quite the opposite. I'm actually here to say that if we could look back and get a picture of who we are because of who we were, then we'll have a better picture of who we can be in the future. So renewing of our church humbly and boldly, that actually just celebrates who we were and who I believe in God we can be. Because in amongst that reality that there is, there are still wonderful
people in the Methodist family who are full of heart and vibe and want to do stuff, and they're alive in God. And so that gives me heart as well that God's not given up on us yet. But somehow, it feels to me so often we've just become so calcified, restricted by the stuff of institutionalism, which is no one's fault. It's just sometimes what happens, that we've just become entrapped in our life together. And to appropriate that heartwarming sentiment of Charles Wesley's hymn, which we're not singing today, I long, for Methodism's chains to fall off and our hearts to be free again. And so, that's my creed occur, my cry of my heart, that we rediscover our reason for being. Leonard Sweet, who I'm going to quote again, a bit of an American Wesleyan writer, professor, he says, "What the Spirit is up to in the new Reformation," we'll just talk about that in a bit, "is not about making a better church, but making a better world." And surely that's what we're all about. So again, if you want to leave now because you think you don't like the cry of my heart, then please do.
Good. Okay. There we are.
So I've got about eight chapters, eight bits. This is like a sermon on steroids. Steroids. So there we go. And then we'll wrap up. Because in a sense, in my head, they're all parts of a jigsaw about how we rediscover our being. I hope this is okay. All right. Okay.
First of all, then, the people called Methodists, confident about our why. I did think I'd intersperse it by singing a few Wesley hymns as we go. So that's what we're going to do now. Charge to keep. I have some great hymns with some reasonable tunes, isn't there? So here we go. A charge to keep I have, a God to glorify, an ever-dying soul to save, and fitted for the sky, to serve the present age, my calling to fulfill. Oh, may it all my powers engage to do my master's will. You'll know there are more verses, but we've got to crack on. So Leonard Sweet, what do you reckon to this? I think this is a great quote. Leonard Sweet writes, "I believe God's clock keeps perfect time. I believe God may have raised up John Wesley as much for the 21st century as for the 18th century. I believe that even though what we now call Methodism is in too many ways what Wesley came to get rid of, it need not come to this. Sometimes our solutions lie as much in the past as in the present or the future. I believe what historians call the Methodist Revolution is an unfinished revolution. Scripture, Genesis 26:18, Isaac dug again the wells of water that had been dug in the days of his father Abraham, for the Philistines had stopped them up after the death of Abraham. He gave them the names that his father had given them. It's sometimes a favourite text on anniversary days. But it's resonant with that sense of there's good stuff. There's a well with living water, and somehow we need to be able to tap into that. So, the people called Methodists, confident about our why. Are we confident about our why? Just have a chat to the person next to you, or if you're really introverted, just yourself, about why Methodism in the 21st century? Why Methodism in the 21st century? Just because we've not quite wound out of the block yet, or why Methodism in the 21st century?
Literally a minute or not more. Right, okay, let's come back to you.
We usually get you the most wisdom in the first minute anyway, don't you? So, who'd like to say anything? And I'll repeat it because we haven't got roving mics. So, who'd like to say anything? Why Methodism in the 21st century? Oh, you were just talking about the coffee. Oh, yeah, John. Okay, connecting other Christians together. So we're the jam in the sandwich sometimes, yeah. When the Anglicans and the Catholics can't get on, then we're in the middle to make it all right. More than that.
I know. Sorry. Yeah. Go on.
Yeah. Okay. No. So we that's right. Broad and diverse. Yeah. All linking people together. Anyone else? Leanne? Okay, so actually, when we look at our world, there's much about the 18th century kind of landscape, but we might say, gosh, that's relevant to who we are now. Ruth? All right, Acts of Children. Yeah, all we can. So we're busy doing stuff as the Methodist family, ways that get forgotten. Or not remembered enough. Jude? Work to do. Excellent. God's love is for all. Yeah, it's great. Excellent. Thank you. Basically, Karen. As a society, we're accountable for shaping how we move forward. I just want to spend some time thinking about this question why, because I think it really matters. Some of you may be familiar with Simon Sinek, who's an American organizational writer and person. And he writes quite a book, probably his most famous book, and the thing that made him famous was Start With Why, where he says that actually the why of any organization is the central belief that really, really matters. And that's what's going to make the difference for any organization. As he said, it's a concept that motivates you to get out of bed in the morning in terms of an organization. It's the reason you're in business. And it really matters, doesn't it, having a why. If you don't know why you're doing something, it becomes a lot of hard work quite quickly. A compelling why underpins and releases zeal, great Methodist words, which we'll come back to, zeal, and enthusiasm, and passion. And so I think it's a really important question for us, for the people called Methodists, to be clear, is why we exist. Not just why we used to exist, but why under God we exist here and now for the 21st century. Because if we're more confident about our why, then I think it becomes our tuning fork, it becomes our rallying cry, it helps us to know what we're praying for, it helps us to know how we're waiting on God, it helps us to know what our mission and discipleship is. So, the importance of that. I want to affirm other questions, which Simon Sinek would say are lesser questions, which are about important, but like next degree questions about what and how. And I think oftentimes in the Methodist Church we end up talking about what and how rather than why. So, you know, you're probably familiar with this, John the Lord, it's been around since 2000. The calling of the Methodist Church is to respond to God's gospel, God's loving Christ, to live out his discipleship, worship, mission. It's fine and dandy. And we do that by worship, learning, caring, service, evangelism. This is good, but it seems to be more than not, it offers us a framework for our activity and our understanding of ourselves. I've not heard anybody yet come to me and say, you know that our calling. God, blimey, it makes my heart go on fire. But it's good, and it's thorough, and it tells us. But, you know, arguments are, so what's different about the Methodist Church when you say that to most other churches? Maybe nothing, and maybe that's fine. In 2018, when we decided that we liked this quite a lot and came back to it with a bit more intensity, there was a report at a conference that said, these are the things that we need to attend to because we're making this our priority, to make more followers of Jesus Christ, to help members deepen their faith. Yes, these are all, yes, I'll stop saying this. To find ways to support the improvement of the quality of worship offered to God, yes. To support and development of district and circuit mission plans. You love doing that, don't you? To grow the number, variety, and breadth of vocations. To develop the property of the church to support mission and evangelism. To be a more inclusive, welcoming church. Yes. To evaluate and revise decision-making processes of the church so that they are effective and efficient, enabling the church to pursue its commitment to mission. Yes. To enable the church to be a good neighbour, to ensure the church fulfills its regulatory and good oversight responsibilities. Yes, all of that, yes. All of that, yes. But it doesn't excite and it doesn't get to the heart of things I would want to say. And I should have said at the start, there will be a moment, at least, in
everything I say, when at least one of you disagrees with something I'm saying, I think so. You know, feel free to disagree, please, because this is me. Okay.
So, partial. So, back to our why. And I want to say that our why comes from looking back. Simon Sinek again says this: the why doesn't come from looking ahead at what you want to achieve, figuring out an appropriate strategy to get there. It's not born out of market research. It doesn't come from extensive interviews with customers or even employees. He's not talking about church. It comes from looking in the completely opposite direction from where you are now. Finding why is a process of discovery, not invention. The hard part is the discipline to trust one's gut, to stay true to one's purpose, cause, or beliefs. Remaining completely in balance and authentic is the most difficult part. So, why has God called us to be the people called Methodists, and now here we are in the 21st century? What's our distinctive and unique nature? And how do we answer that in any such way that our hearts are racing, that our minds are alive, and we're captivated by it, and we're increasingly willing and desiring to live sacrificial lives? Elaine Heath is an American Methodist, who puts it like this, that we need to see the tradition behind the traditions. We need to see why we do what we do now, what actually was the reason why we ever started to do what we do now, and then we can get to the real issue. Should we still be doing what we do now, or do we need to do something else? Yeah? Okay, so here's a little bit about the why as was. And some of this you'll discover. So 1763.
John Wesley was asked at one of the early conferences, or he asked himself probably, what may we reasonably believe to be God's purpose in raising up preachers called Methodists? This was his answer: to reform the nation and in particular the church, to spread scriptural holiness over the land. In 1820, the Liverpool Conference, which is famous because they received statistics that showed the Methodist family was starting to contract rather than expand, and so they had a crisis conference, as it were. And there, they said, they reaffirmed to spread scriptural holiness through the land, and never regard this as the first and great calling of the Methodist people. And then in 1932, the Deed of Union. Some of this we all have, them, many of you. Deed of Union. The form of words was brought together there. And some people argue, well, that was just, you know, Prims and Westings finally managing to get on and produce some words that made enough sense for them to be able to sign off it, like Brexit deal, except in reverse. But there we are. We said it. And we said it like this. Everyone remembers that in the providence of God, Methodism was raised up to spread scriptural holiness through the land by the proclamation of the evangelical faith. That is like just good standard Christian good news. And he declares, God, we didn't half go for it, did we? He declares its unfaltering resolve to be true to its divinely appointed mission. This was heavy laden, wasn't it? You know, if you think that just was a compromise, that maybe defeats that argument. He declares its unfaltering resolve to be true to its divinely appointed mission. 2013, and this is interesting, when it looked like the Anglican and Methodist Church were moving closer together, that seems to be a bit fragmented at the moment. Anyway, we're still in covenant, but this was one of the reports. Methodism has always seen its reason for existence as a mission, and then the bit from the Deed of Union. Then that thought was really interesting at the end. Theoretically, at least, it has seen the way it is structured as being contingent on achieving that end. Isn't that an interesting line to put in? Theoretically, at least. And what's interesting, I think, is that you can go on many, many church websites who've wondered what to put about why Methodism is, and they'll quote the Deed of Union, and then you'll get nothing ever again on the website that says anything about it. So we have these words that we have, and we kind of trot out, but I don't think they have the energy and the life and the coherence that they used to have. And I'm aware that there's maybe some of you saying at this point, oh, not all that old phrase again, spreading scriptural. And I think actually the point is yes, if we take seriously that we work out our why by looking back and unpacking some of this. So Ken Howcroft again. I never knew I loved Ken Howcroft so much until I did my sabbatical. So when in his presidential address in 2014, he said those words, still are the basis of our church, our confidence, our connection. But then he asks, do we still ever remember what it says? Do we know what our divinely appointed mission is? And do we still have an unfaltering resolve to be true to it? Now, spreading scriptural holiness through the land needs a bit of unpacking. We'll do it. Because it's like words that are just, you know, they're not easy words for us. We need to do some unpacking. But I just want to say that I think we need to look back if we're going to look forward and find God's promise for what lies ahead. Back to Leonard Sweet again. It's time that the people called Methodists show some originality. In its truest sense, originality means a return to origins or a rediscovery of one's roots, not merely to reproduce the current original, which is self-extinction, but to recapitulate the original in the current context. I love this phrase. A fresh choreography for the daily life of an old dance. All the best things I say today have been said by other people. That's a great phrase. A fresh choreography for the daily life of an old dance. So that's my foundation, if you like. That we need to be more confident about our why comes most securely from looking back. Not through rose-tinted spectacles, but seeing what the why was as our original movement and how that why can take us forward. Chapter 2. I'll lose count. The people called Methodists on fire with the gospel. On fire with the gospel. The good news. God, that's, you know, heart warmed. Here, let's have a sing. See how great a flame aspires, kindled by a spark of grace. Jesus, love the nation's fires, set the kingdoms on a blaze. To bring fire on earth he came, kindled in some hearts it is. Oh, let all men catch the flame, all partake the glorious bliss.
Right, keep your weight.
About a century ago, Sangster wrote a book, Methodists Can Be Born Again. It's a really contemporary read. But I love this illustration that he uses, which is in a way a segue from what I was to say to this. He tells of a man who went into a restaurant and ordered a lunch. When the waiter brought the soup, it was a poor, colourless, and uninviting liquid, and tasted no better than it looked. So the hungry fellow called the waiter back. Waiter, he asked, what soup is this? Said the waiter, no particular soup, sir, just soup. Ah, said the diner as he gazed on the watery scene, I see, and only just. Now what Sangster was placing there was not a press against ecumenical relationships at all, or being part of the wider church family, but actually quite the opposite. What he was pressing the case for was every denomination and every church network to bring their distinctiveness to the table. So that, as Sangster goes on to say, we can cherish as a dear possession those facets of truth which God gave to our branch of the church and bear it forward as a definite part of the whole glory which is yet to be revealed, seeking in a spirit of charity to understand what others have found precious in their communion, but not forgetting as a good steward that we have something to give as well as to gain. I think that's really good. So in galvanizing around what we call our sacred mandate, our divinely appointed mission, it's really important that we inhabit and recognize and focus our life on the distinctive charisms of our movement, to quote again, the traditions behind the traditions. And that starts, I think, for us as Methodist folks, as being captivated by the astonishing good news of the gospel. And if we ever get bored of the gospel, and it stopped being good news. It's always going to be good, but you know, sometimes it just stops being news. It's got to be good news for us, as well as for all the people in the world who don't know it's good or bad news. But it needs to be good news for us. So that extraordinary story of God's love and grace, how we want to say, don't we as the people called Methodists, how much the world needs to know and discover the riches of life, the inexhaustible, comprehensive love of God, the God who breathed life into creation, who gives life to every person, the God who loves us from the start of time, the God who can't possibly love us more than he loves us now, and will never love us less, the God who saves us from ourselves, who wants to assure us that sin doesn't have the first word and it won't have the last word, the God who wants to ensure our eternal flourishing, the God who would rather die than live without us, the God who wants to fill our lives with his presence and enable us to discover life in all its fullness to flourish.
This is the good news, the astonishing good news of the gospel, which should be motivating us.
Call to live, love, and praise was a Methodist church statement in 1999. And the way it works, as I understand it, if the church issues a statement, then it really means it. Okay. So this is really meant. And it's great, I think, in saying this in much more profound ways than I just did it. At the heart of this gospel is the revelation that God is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit embrace the world. Each member of the human race and every living creature with a love which not only creates but recreates and heals in the face of humankind's tragic, self-centered fragmentation. This is God's mission to the world. God does not exist in isolation or detachment from creation, but with the passionate care of a father or mother engages with it, inviting humankind to find its lasting center and home in the divine love. This love is the ultimate, inescapable center and framework of all things. For this reason, the Bible bears witness to the kingdom of God, for God, in spite of the dark abysses of human history, suffering, and even death, raised. The climax of the biblical testimony to the mission and kingdom of God is the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus, God's ultimate act of solidarity with the sacrifice of the world, and God's definitive victory over evil. Out of this gospel, the church gladly acknowledges its vocation to celebrate the love of God in its worship, to share its life in its fellowship, and to be the agent of its generosity and compassion in a needy world. That's the more formal way of putting it.
But that's good stuff as well, isn't it?
And we really meant it, because that's a statement. That's a statement.
Okay.
So, Methodism can be born again, captivated by the good news of the gospel. Now, here's some Wesleyan stuff. Responding to a seeking and ascending God. Now distinctively, but not uniquely, we don't claim this as only the Methodists know about God. But distinctively, the Wesleyan movement, John Wesley's part of his inspiration, was recognizing God's heart and mission as both seeking and sending. Michael Beck, who I'll quote quite a bit of this morning, another Fresh Expressions Methodist from America, said this: John Wesley experienced God as a seeking and sending God whose essential nature is love. This mindset fueled his actions. John Wesley himself said, "Yet the shepherd of souls sought after us and went after us in the wilderness. And oughtest now not thou to have compassion on thy fellow servants as he had pity on thee? Ought we not also to seek as far as in us lies and to save that which is lost?" So, this interplay of recognizing God as the God who seeks us out and draws us in and then
sends us out, seeking, sending God. And of course, that was John Wesley's story, wasn't it, in part? That he was sought by God, he was so close, and yet he still needed more seeking out, and he was found. And then he went on this journey where, albeit massively reluctantly, he ended up going beyond pulpit to field and doing all that field preaching and getting really involved out there in the world. So he was sought,
and then he went out and was sent. Leonard Sweet, you see, I read a few books, here he is again. The essence of Methodism's genius resides in two famous Wesleyan mantras: heart strangely warmed, and the world is our parish. For Wesley, internal combustion, the former, led to external combustion, the latter. So Beck says, who I referred to earlier, he says, we would do well to continue to emphasize a personal experience of a seeking and sending Trinitarian God whose primary characteristic is relentless love. One of the ways in which John Wesley tried to renew the church, or did renew the church, was to move away from a largely attractional form of church, which says, we're here if you want to come. And we mean it so much, we've just put up a new notice board to really tell you we're here if you want to come. But actually, to move from that to passively go out to see and to spread and to send the mission and the love of God. And he recognized at that time that that was a vital missing ingredient. Just not that rhythm of seeking and sending. Now, as I say, it's not unique to the people of called Methodists. So we understand this about God and no one else. But it is part, I would say, of our divinely appointed mission. The Methodist movement rose up with this at its heart, and it began to play its part in the renewal of the church by bringing this to life. A heart so full of perfect love that God reaches out to us and invites us to join in his mission. And it starts to frame for us, I think, what we mean by scriptural holiness. I think I wrote this. I wrote so much when I was on sabbatical, and I didn't always attribute it, but I think I wrote this. So God is firstly a seeking God, seeking us out. But then he sends us out to share that love with the same passion by which we were sought. Those two things, that final bit is really important. The same passion by which we were sought. And if we need to know more passion in ourselves, then we need to wait on God and ask for more, don't we? Of course, it's not a unique insight, but it does light the heart of life. This is at our heart, embodying both the seeking and sending nature. Is that okay? Sorry, we will have more time to discuss it, but I think it might be best just if I plow on whilst you're not throwing anything at me. Okay. Renewing our appreciation of holiness. Can't talk about spreading scriptural holiness before we have to talk about holiness for a while. Henry Knight, an American author, writes this about holiness. Holiness of heart and life, centered on love for God and neighbor, was the orientating goal of the mission. The polity of the Methodist movement was never an end to itself, but it was always intended to serve the mission. The discipline, classes, bands, itinerant preachers, connection and conference, all designed to enable the movement to fulfill its purpose of renewing lives, the church, and the nation. Elaine Heath again. The church is called holy, wrote John Wesley, because it is holy. This needs not be a cloistered holiness, but it is intentional and communal, a holiness in the midst of the stresses and strains of everyday life. If we can recover that, she says, we will recover a church that is vital and effective for the 21st century. It seems to me it's really important that we spend some time, not just this morning, because I've got long enough to do lots of it, on this word holiness,
because it's so easily misconstrued, I think, and it's weaponized into a moral do not do this and do not do that, and you know, holiness is a negative concept. And I've heard that as a description of it relatively recently. Someone actually said, well, of course we're called to spread scriptural holiness, by which they then wanted the next sentence to say, so we ought to be jolly well telling people what they shouldn't be doing.
Which I'm not saying that's never part of what we're here to do, but for me, I think I see holiness as such a much richer thing than that, because it's all about what we were talking about, love. It's all about God's love filling us so that we are made holy in his love. We're sought in that love and we go out to spread that love. And I think Elaine, he starts to put it for me in the right sort of framework. If we can recover that, we'll recover a church that's vital and effective in the 21st century. So discovering an appreciation of holiness again, and then recognizing the breadth and the depth of holiness. And we just need to spend a little bit of time here as well, because holiness is so important for us as Methodists.
Is it?
It was. And it needs to be. I think it needs to be. The breadth and depth of holiness. Personal holiness. So there's three things that were really important phrases that we have when we talk about Wesleyan understanding of holiness. The first is personal holiness. This is personal. Warmed heart, response, God reaching out to you, to me, personal, that personal connection, when for you your chains fell off, for you when you knew that God was doing something in your life, afresh, personal holiness, the start of a journey not just the start, but the start of a journey that then leads on to a recognition just of how much God loves you and wants your life to flourish in him. This is what John Wesley wrote. Who's a Methodist according to your own account? A Methodist is one who has the love of God shed abroad in his, that's his time, heart by the Holy Ghost given unto him. One who loves the Lord his God with all his heart, with all his soul, with all his mind, with all his strength. That's the pinnacle of personal holiness. It's not a narrow, I hate the world kind of thing. It's a holiness that is on fire because of love. Personal holiness, that's the first thing. Then secondly, really important for us as Methodists, social holiness. Recognizing that we can't be filled and full and flourish in the love of God on our own easily. So, John Wesley, recognize that personal holiness, growing in love, seeking after Christian perfection, could only be worked out with others. As he said, holy solitaries is a phrase no more consistent with the gospel than holy adulterers. The gospel of Christ knows of no religion but social, no holiness but social holiness. Really, really big thing, and we'll come back to this later. The fact that we're called to do this stuff together, that really, really matters. Hence bands and classes and societies and fellowship and all those things. And we'll come back to some of that. But it really matters. We can't do it on our own. We're not meant to do it on our own, Wesley would tell us. Can I just note that note at the bottom that social holiness is not the same as social justice, which is sometimes what we say. Oh yeah, we know we're into social holiness, by which we think that means all the stuff we do out there. This is different to that. We are into social justice, but this is different to that. This, as I understand it, is the way in which we together grow in our holiness. Yeah? So we're called to personal holiness, and we become personally more holy by doing it with others. That makes sense? And then an outpouring, an interleaving of all that is the social justice that we come. Okay. And then, we're finally getting to it, aren't we? So personal holiness, social holiness, and then scriptural holiness. Our mandate to spread scriptural holiness through the land is, well, let's say the first thing, comprehensive, Andrew's point. For all, this is for all. This is the great conviction of the people called Methodists, and it's for all, Armenian. It's for all. And we all love everybody. It's just Lucy I can't stand. We're all in that thing. But God's conviction is and pull on our lives is to say it's for all. Now I said this at a conference this summer. These bullet points. I didn't have that fancy phrase at the start, but here we are. In the multifaceted, complex, hugely variegated 21st century, it's a rallying call to reach into every heart and home, every neighborhood and network, every corridor of power and community at the margin, every inch of our land, and every corner of cyberspace. What I was trying to say at conference was you know, can we not just believe it again within our souls that actually the people called Methodists are called into every inch of life, to offer God's love to every person to whom we can offer it, and to in every strata of society that we can reach, and every place of decision-making and where there is no decision-making that is possible, into every place of community. That's what we mean when we say spread scriptural holiness through the land, isn't it? Through the land. You know, what I just put in my bullet points was through the land. Explore a little bit of the 21st century. Everywhere. That's our mandate. Scriptural holiness. Let's not forget everything else, if you agree with it, that I've been saying thus far about who we are in God. This is a hugely positive thing. You know, let's This may be the only time I mention it this morning. That's the intention. Let God in love unites us. We need to be really careful that that doesn't help. That doesn't take the wheels off the bus, actually. Because our mandate lives beyond and within and across and broader and all the more than just that issue, important as it is. Spreading scriptural holiness through the land is offering the perfect, unconditional love of God to every soul and to every place and to seeking to make that real for people's lives. Elaine Heath again, reflecting on early Methodism, a holiness movement that evangelized people both inside and outside the church. Methodism was a holiness movement that initiated people into a holy life, revealed in Jesus Christ, anchored in the church, empowered by the Holy Spirit, surrendered to the reign of God, for, and I think this is probably my key phrase here, for the transformation of the world. What do we think spreading scriptural holiness is about? It's about God's transformation of the world so that his kingdom is here on earth as it is in heaven. And the fullness of God's love is set free within the world. That, I think, is our divinely appointed mission that we're called to follow with unfaltering resolve. And it is really broad, and Wesley gave us an extraordinary example. You know, one life, crikey, it just makes me feel completely useless. But,
you know, in terms of what he did, in terms of his preaching and his reaching out to people, in terms of he went and gave lectures at Oxford and Cambridge and other places, he was part of the fight for the abolition of slavery. He went to prisons and served and sought to serve the prisons there. He was at the forefront of campaigns against social justice, and he set such an example,
a liberating example of what this means, spreading scriptural. It's rich and full of life. Next chapter, I've already lost count. Captivated by grace. We're doing okay. Are we all right for a bit longer before we have a break? Is that all right? Yeah. Okay. Captivated by grace. Grace alongside holiness is a key word. And I would want to say that grace perhaps gives us an even more liberating way of viewing things and is important. So captivated, the people called Methodist, captivated by grace. So here we have another verse of a great hymn. Father of everlasting grace, your goodness and your truth we praise. Your goodness and your truth we praise. You have in honor of your Son the gift unspeakable sent down. Spirit of life and power and love. So we're going to spend a little bit of time thinking about grace, okay? And we're heading in part two to thinking a bit more practically about some of the stuff that I think is about how we shape ourselves. But here I'm still putting down some what I think are really important foundation blocks for us to remember and to value. So returning to Simon Sinek just for a minute, as to our why being spreading scriptural holiness and how we regard personal and social holiness as a vital part of that. So the how, if you like, is through first responding to the grace of God and then living responsibly in the grace of God. So John Wesley preached a lot about grace. His journal was full of entries that say things like, I offer the grace of God. I offer the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. I proclaimed free salvation. I declared the free grace of God. Here's a longer quote from John Wesley on grace. God's bounty or favor is free, undeserved favor. Man of his time, man having no claim to the least of his mercies. It was free grace that formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into him a living soul and stamped on that soul the image of God and put all things under his feet, for there's nothing we are or have or do which can deserve the least thing at God's hand. So the grace of God, as we inherit the riches of our understanding, which again are not unique and we don't say they are, but the riches of our understanding of grace. So one of the things that I was reading and really took me during my sabbatical was thinking about waves of grace and means of grace. Well, we're familiar with the word means of grace, and we're familiar to an extent with waves of grace. But a way of describing our connection with God's grace. So first of all, through waves of grace. First of all, prevenient. Some of you will be familiar with these. Some of you have done essays and all the rest of it, different grades. Prevenient, justifying, sanctifying. Let's just have a look at these, though, just for a bit. Prevenient grace, ahead of us. It's that grace of God which is out there, is present in all creation, in human conscience, in relationships, and the heritage into which we're born. It's God's grace. God's grace is not just, you know, in a bottle and then we'll shake a bit out. God's grace is out there. That's prevenient grace. It's ahead of us. John Wesley would say, if I were to write my own life, I should begin it before I was born. True. But he would say that about grace. God's grace was there before him. And so prevenient grace has been described a little bit like the porch on a house. It's where we prepare to enter the house. It's where we maybe just find our first entry into God's stuff, the love of God. When I saw that image of the porchway of the home, then what I immediately thought of was the father of the prodigal son, as an example in a sense of that prevenient grace at that point. This is not a perfect analogy, but I hope it was. You know, so the prodigal son has wished his dad dead and gone off, you know the story. And in my head, I always have the father just scouring the landscape every day, just longing and hoping and praying for. Now, in a sense, that's prevenient grace. It's grace that's there before anything else happens. Prevenient grace. So I like the idea of the father on the porch, you know, looking at, will this be the day when he comes home? Prevenient grace. And we give thanks for prevenient grace because it's how God reaches out to us, and we don't earn it, and we don't necessarily seek it. He comes to us, and we're offered grace. Justifying grace. Justification, said John Wesley, is another word for pardon. It's the forgiveness of all our sins and our acceptance with God. And it is, if you like, the doorway into a new identity. We don't use this word justifying very often in this kind of way, but those of you who use computers and do word processing, you'll justify your text sometimes, won't you? You're left justified, you're right justified. There are some nods and some yeah. But it's the way you get your text all aligned down the side, which really neat. It's really satisfying on the right. That's getting it right, justifying the text. And it's getting it right. So it's about being forgiven, whatever language you want to say, about being put right with God, about God coming in and giving us grace and enabling us to discover who we are. It's been reconciled, realigned with God, and the acceptance of God's, all that God has done for us in Jesus, adopting us into his new life. So for Wesley, his description of his experience at Aldersgate Street in May 24, 1738, maybe that portrays for us the meaning of justifying grace. So it wouldn't have been a proper gathering if we didn't have the little quote, would it? About a quarter before nine. While the leader was describing the change which God works in the heart through faith in Christ, I felt my heart strangely warmed. I felt I did trust in Christ. Christ alone for salvation, and an assurance was given me that he had taken away my sins, even mine, and saved me from the law of sin and death. There have been lots, you know, he was a priest, for goodness sake. so there was all that there. But for him, this was the moment when he stepped into the doorway of a new identity, where he had another great Methodist word, assurance. He had assurance about who he was. And then sanctifying. God's grace perfecting us, saying, God loves us just as we are, but he loves us so much he doesn't want to leave us as we are. That he wants to continue his work in us. And so that's described in this analogy as being just entering into the rooms of God's dwelling, that we learn and we grow and we develop and we blossom.
Sanctifying grace, as I read it, is God's freely given presence and power to restore the fullness of God's image in which we were created. It's about making us who we were meant to be. And Wesley talked about this and talked about Christian perfection, which we're all in wrong with this morning, but it's interesting stuff, by which he means that we have an entire holiness of heart and life. We become the real deal as God intended us to be.
That's the ambition. So, prevenient, God reaches out, takes hold of us, grabs us, justifying. It works within us. We recognize all that God is for us. And then the work continues and we carry on. I don't know if this works or not, but I was thinking about prevenient being that finding. God's finding grace, he finds us. Justifying, God's forgiving grace, he forgives us and makes us who we're meant to be. And then sanctifying, God's forming grace. So the work is on. The challenge is on to make us all that we could be. And the early Methodists were tremendously ambitious in God, in what God could do. Tremendously ambitious about what God could do in their lives. That's a great Methodist thing, to be ambitious about what God can still do in our life. Means of grace, then. People familiar with that thought of means of grace? How do we describe it? God's ways invisibly. God's work invisibly in his disciples, hastening, strengthening, confirming faith so that God's grace pervades in and through disciples. So those are ways of describing it, but here are some of the means of grace. I'm sorry if it went a bit small. Worship and prayer, ministry of the word, searching the scriptures, Lord's Supper, fasting and abstinence, Christian conferencing or Christian conversation, acts of mercy and compassion. All of these through our Wesleyan heritage are part of what we think of as means of grace. Ways in which we grow. And they're not just tools. Well, thank goodness I went to service on Sunday, even though I was bored silly, because at least that was a means of grace. I know that never happens at this time, but it's about God's activity through that thing. And communion, I think, is a really interesting one, isn't it? Lord's Supper, I think it's a really interesting one, because it can become mechanical, and it can become, when did my turn? And it becomes so miserable. Why the heck is it so miserable? But that's another thing. And in these COVID times, I don't know if you use these things there, which are fine and necessary for COVID, I'm not, but it does introduce an interesting element. God, here's the broken view. And then everyone's going with taking the lid off the little capsule to get the wafer. And then they can't open the little capsule to get the wine, and it all dribbles everywhere. Of course, none of it in and of itself is a means of grace, because we've done it. We've struggled with the capsule and got it out, most of it being on the carpet. But actually, to recognize that in the midst of there, it's a longing that we will be drawn closer to God, that we'll draw closer to God and know his promise that he draws closer to us. And so it is, that even sometimes, and maybe too often, it feels a bit humdrum and going, but actually, you'll know those moments in your life's story when actually it's meant all the world. And it's been transforming. It's been amazing. And then it's been a means of grace. And so it is that, Christian conversation isn't always a means of grace. is sometimes. It is sometimes, isn't it? So these things are really important, and we're called not to neglect them. And although I've been a bit disparaging about them, actually, it's really important, I think, that we take them all seriously. And that we cope with them when they're ordinary and it feels a bit dull. Bad phrase coming up. When they're not working. Because you never know when it is going to work. So that's really sloppy language. But you know what I mean? You never know when God's going to. So that's why we've got to stick at it. That's why you've got to stick at reading your Bible, even when it's flipping hard work and you haven't understood half the word. Or even when you think that has no relevance. You've got to stick at it because you never know. Because it is a means of grace. You've got to stick at it. You've got to stick at it. And Randy Maddox, that's the name to conjure with, isn't it? Randy Maddox is an American writer, done a lot of work that we now draw on in supervision. And he has this phrase, which we now use in our supervision, responsible grace. A really important phrase, responsible grace. That actually we're given this grace, but we have a responsibility to play our part. Part of that is about how we use the means of grace. Michael Beck again says this, God wants to restore us fully to the divine image, God's masterpiece, enable us to completely love God and neighbor. Yet this doesn't occur passively. Our life becomes a lived response to God's grace. Our development requires some faith work on our part. As James reminds us, faith is dead when it doesn't result in faithful activity. Wesley believed this movement along the way of salvation, which is a phrase that you used a lot, and I've used only a little, marks our lives in a special way. We grow in both personal and social holiness along this journey of grace through the means of grace. And then he continues. Methodists continue to emphasize a personal experience of a seeking, ascending, Trinitarian God whose primary characteristic is relentless love. We've had that phrase a few times today. I love that phrase, relentless love. We experience the missional love of God through waves of grace, revealing, justifying, sanctifying, and means of grace. Prayer, searching, scripture, communion, passing over. The discipleship process is connected to these means of grace and waves of grace, to the profuse outflow of God's unconditional love. Maybe we've gone a bit under the engine, under the bonnet. I think it's really important that we explore what we're talking about, because what we've been talking about so far is a lot about how we'll unpack our lie, spread scriptural holiness. What's holiness about? What's grace about? How do we receive grace?
How do we grow in grace? How are we responsible about grace? The means of grace.
I think if I just take my chance, I'll just do one more chapter and then we'll stop. Is that okay, or is anyone absolutely desperate for coffee? Where are we? Another 10 minutes or something like that. Okay. Bit of a change of scene there. Okay.
The people called Methodists are both and people. So being a Methodist, being Wesleyan, means you can have your cake and eat it. Does it? No. Let's see. This is an important Methodist thing, which I have to say, sorry folk who know Methodist history more than me, this was kind of a novel idea process for me and my sabbatical when I read about this. Conjunctive theology, nothing to do with the sore eye, but just putting things together. Okay, and this thought that actually John Wesley brought to bear a holding together of things that was quite remarkable. And I just wanted to think about this for a few minutes. So, if we think about Wesley's own tensions within himself, Anglican priest remaining thoroughly committed to seeing the Methodist movement within the Anglican Church a renewing force, committed to his dying breath that it should not leave and become a separate church. Remaining a movement within the Anglican Church was a key way, actually, in which Wesley hoped that we would fulfill our mission of renewing the church. So he had his internal tensions about his identity. And Methodism, as it grew, as Wesley died, had its tensions, which were sadly, so sadly, proved to be irreconcilable for many years. But this is a great phrase, I think, from the aforementioned Randy Maddox. Wesley held things together that other Christians pushed apart. I don't really want to misquote what you were saying, Alan, at all, but I just think there's something there, at least to add on to what you were saying about the Methodist way, that we're holding together things that other Christians push apart. This isn't to get around it, I'm just saying that this is us at our best. This is us at our best. So, just quoting from a book that I read about this, the call to take the seat, the potential of this both and theology is to take the call to take seeds of Wesley's organizing principles and practices and then replant them on the new missional frontier. For instance, the greatest and of the Methodist movement is rarely even recognized, that John Wesley was a faithful Anglican priest until the day he died, and a missional renegade who preached into the fields. He sustained a tether back to the inherited church and encouraged people to participate fully in life, and yet he said where church structures constrained the focus on missional evangelism, he laid them aside. He was a man who challenged the inherited system deeply while trying to bring renewal to it. He held together competing ideas that divided believers in his day in creative tension. And then this quote from Randy Maddox, that is quoted by another writer who says this: I recall vividly when Randy Maddox, in one of my classes on the history and theology of Methodism, said that Wesley held things together that other Christians pushed apart. I am still floored by the degree to which that statement is true. Wesley loved the church fathers and contemporary theologians of his day. He was a loyal Anglican, even though his efforts were often unsupported. He appreciated the Book of Common Prayer and extemporaneous prayer. He loved scripture, but also recognized the need for community and spiritual formation. He loved the sacraments, but wasn't above preaching in a field or on top of a grave to reach people he needed to reach. In other words, Methodists at our core, are both and, rather than either or Christians. We are naive enough to believe that we really should have our cake and eat it. He brought things together from many different traditions in a unique and interesting synthesis. I think we need to reclaim that. And I just long that we could have a sense of that more. Especially when we agonize and worry about whether we're a movement or a church. And we've been playing around this all my life. We're a movement or a church. And we say church when we think it's boring. And the movement sounds really sexy and exciting. Oh, we'd love to be a movement. But what about the fact that actually we could be a movement and a church? We can't take away the fact that we are now a church with however many hundreds of years of history and all that's good about it. But we desperately need to be have a sense of movement and renewal. So maybe there's one thing that we don't have to pick one or the other, but actually we can hang together. Now, Clive Marsh, who was past vice president a couple of years ago, this is a great quote, I think, in Unplugging Methodist Theology. Methodism is a movement, and at its best is passionate evangelism wedded to a burning zeal for social action. If Methodism did not exist, it would have to be invented. He was on a roll when he said this. The dynamic combination of Christian social action and intelligent evangelism is arguably a uniquely concentrated ecclesial embodiment within a social denomination. He's a professor. But actually, if you just live with it for a minute, it's a uniquely concentrated ecclesial church, embodiment within a social denomination. Both and. And I think that's what still warms my heart about Methodism, that actually we are, yes, thank you, Clive, at our best, at our very best, we're that. We're that. So I'm pressing the case for a renewed, relaxed, expansive, permission-giving culture and self-understanding of who we are. We're not we're expansive, we're comprehensive, we're passionate about evangelism. Thank you. We all say thank you to those wonderful evangelists. We're passionate about social action. Thank you for those who are passionate about social action. And we just celebrate that we've got this great thing which is both and not either or. And we celebrate the allness of all of that. And I believe it can be a real way in which we relax a bit ourselves, so that we just relax. We don't have to take ourselves too seriously. We don't need to worry about being a church that's getting all around all the time. So the inherited church, we can be authentic to our calling to renew the church. We can say, yes, we need to be renewing the inheritance. So the fresh expression movement, as it seeks ways to embody what's new alongside the inherited, we can provide a rootedness which is resourcing and protecting without smothering or constraining. That's a gift, because otherwise you end up being either all about fresh expression or all about inheritance. But actually, I think the genius that we've got here, we would realize it, is that we can be both that's our inheritance. So here we go. This is nearly the last slide. Now. The last slide for coffee. You get your desperate. So when fresh expression started to happen, right at the start of the century, or the tail end of the last century, Rowan Williams, who was the flag bearer for fresh expression and the new ways of doing mission, Rowan Williams, he got the mission shaped movement going. And he talked about a mixed economy. We need the inherited alongside the new. Over time, other people have talked about mixed ecology, which feels a little bit more agricultural and organic and I like that, mixed ecology. What I was reading on sabbatical was a lot about what they call blended ecology, which I'm not sure has come over here from America, where I read about it so much, but the idea then that Methodism could be a blended ecology that releases all manner of expressions of mission, service, and witnessing, connection, we'll come back to connection, that is mutually supportive, equally valued, and encouraged. There's some really important words there, like equally valued. Blended, because what really matters the most in your circuit life, what are you willing to pour your money in to make sure it doesn't die, and what are you willing to pull your money back from, because you don't mind so much if that dies. Not a level playing field at the moment. Certainly not between inherited and fresh. Just stop. But at a blended ecology that releases all manner of expressions of vision, mutually supportive, equally valued, and encouraged, that blends with the consistency of love, respect, and honouring and appreciation of what's inherited and what's new. We say, thank goodness for this both and, not either or. And enables the old to be renewed by the new, and the new to be informed by the old. In other words, you never get rid of the baby with the bathwater. Is that the phrase? Yes. Don't get rid of the baby. So we need to ditch all that old stuff and do loads of new stuff. And neither do we say we don't need to do new stuff, because we just need to make the old stuff a bit more polished and better. But actually, they both, in a blended ecology, they need each other, and they live off each other. End of part one. Let me pause there.
Does anyone want to make sure we've got time for a longer conversation at the end. That's where I hope that's okay. But I just know that some of you might just be absolutely gagging to say something to me that you think I need to hear. I need to hear lots.
Part of the operation
this morning is that I learn a lot from you at the end of it. Okay.
Anything else just really desperate to say?
Apart from, let me go for coffee. Okay.
Shall we try and be back for just around half past? Is that okay?
Yeah.
Thank you very much, everybody.
I will fear the sons of mine enemies. But all the mountains mine. My cup.
Very reminiscent of 1995. I'm in danger of just losing exactly where we are, but anyway, yeah, I think it's both going alright. Other base angle
effects the same problem we have, which is insulation. Put some anodized
plate,
and car sheeting,
and
just get straight out to the walls
of the windows.
Oh, really?
Oh, lovely, eh? People will be wanting to do...
Have you found any... Have you found any... Do you drive...
Because 20 years ago it wasn't the in thing to do, there was new borders in when I tell you the ocean can't move it. But that's now the push that we lower the carbon footprint of the building.
Yeah.
Just saying, we're facing the same problem as you do, insulation, you know, we're part of the project. She got some in, but we have to go for sort of tunnels. Okay, because we can't put panels on the insulation.
Lots of miniature solar panels.
They heat up, and then do they heat water?
Yeah.
Light.
Yeah. How effective are they? Well, that's, yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, shall we come back together a bit? Okay. Thank you. Anxious that we can have time for conversation. Reasonable time for conversation.
I did write another tune. Would it be all right to do that? So on the other handout that you've got, that we're not going to spend a long time on this handout, I thought it was just interesting reading, I'll refer to it. But at the bottom there's 438, Singing the Faith, 438. Another hymn that I've never picked. Preachers, you picked it? But anyway, but I've not written down the tune, but I've not written down the music for it, but I'll sing it. Set to you. Again, they're just fabulous words, just incredible words. Set to you.
Great words, aren't they? Great words. They get lost in. Right, okay. Thank you for coming back. The people called Methodists renewing the church. I'll try and skip pretty quick through this.
But that was there, wasn't it? Part of our raison d'etre, why renewing the church. And I just think it's really interesting to recognise how important that was for Wesley. So Wesley was keen to develop what was called a practical divinity that emulated from where? From the early church. So not seeking to do something new, but seeking to do something old. And on the handout that you've got, on the same side as where the hymn words were, is a piece from Raymond George, 1963. It doesn't matter if it was so old, because he was talking about things even older. Summarising the dominant characteristics of these 7 points where Methodism echoed the early church. I'm not going to talk about it now, but just read it and see how what he was seeking to bring to life wasn't something new and of itself new, but actually something very old. Which is a constant challenge, isn't it? And then on the other side of the paper is the table, which is from Alan Hirsch, who's way beyond Methodism, but in doing a lot of... he certainly knows how to write a thick book, but some really, really good stuff. So his book's there, Forgotten Ways. And he's really about seeing how the DNA of the early church can be revitalised in fresh ways. So... and I just think it's really interesting, three columns there, of what life was like up until 313-ish, and then the Christendom mode, and then to recognise what he calls the emerging missional mode, and to recognise actually that what has happened since 313 and until relatively recently. Has been a lot of the stuff that's in that middle column, and we want to question whether that's stuff that's good. And if it was good, let's not say it was bad, but is it fit for purpose for a world that is post-Christian and post-nearly everything? And I would want to align myself, I think, with Alan Hirsch. I'm sure he'd be like that I did. And say that actually, I think he's spot on. But it's really interesting, I think, when we try and think, hold this against our patterns of church, that we see so much of the early church there for us as a potential for what comes ahead. I'll leave that there in the interest of time, apart from to recognise, which I think ties in quite neatly with this, what John Wesley had to say about Christendom. Persecution never could give any lasting wound to genuine Christianity. But the greatest it ever received, the grand blow which struck at the very heart of that humble, gentle, patient love, which is the fulfilling of the Christian law and the whole essence of true religion, was struck in the 4th century by Constantine the Great, when he called himself a Christian and poured in a flood of riches, honours and power upon the Christians, more especially upon the clergy. So recognizing, if we're going to be part of what we're doing is renewing the church and taking that seriously, then we need to hear some of this stuff. Two quotes: Stuart Murray Williams, a missiologist, for the church to understand itself as a movement is not a Methodist, not an institution. It needs to know its history and destiny. Movements are dynamic, people sharing history and traditions and journeying together towards a longed for future. And a neighbour, the greatest Christian revolutions came not by the discovery of something that was not known before. They happened when someone takes radically something that was always there. You get used to that being a bit of a motif of mine this morning. Next chapter we're going to do really quickly by mainly virtue of singing a song. but I've written more about it, and I think there is a lot here about being a people willing to give ourselves away, especially in this new post-Christian world. And godly zeal is a really big strand of Methodism and zeal. We were the enthusiasts. Critics criticized for being enthusiastic. We seem to have been really... we've really taken that to heart, haven't we? And we seem to be as keen as possible not to ever have that talked about us again. I would the precious time redeem and longer live for this alone. To just to quote Wesley, a famous quote, but let's not lose sight of it. I'm not afraid that the people called Methodists should ever cease to exist either in Europe or America, but I am afraid lest they should only exist as a dead sect, having the form of religion without the power. They will undoubtedly be the case unless they hold fast both to the doctrine, spirit, and discipline with which they first set. Moving swiftly on. Connection. Just want to talk a little bit about connection. Martin Atkins, he described it as the X factor of Methodism. The X factor of Methodism. I think it's significant. I think it's part of our DNA. I think it's part of our why that we take it seriously, because it is about recognizing that we are. It's this both and, it's this together.
It's that we were able to be, we're able to fulfill a calling, not because we're just individuals, but because we belong together, not just because we're individual churches, but that we belong together. So Leonard Sweet, again, he talks about this word with. With is the contact word, the embrace of grace.
We're passionate about the contacts and connections that constitute a person. A person is never a solo person. A person is always a web of widths, a network of relationships with ramifications that ripple out into the world. Methodism's Trinitarian concept of God is by definition relational. The primacy of relations in both the divine and the human is the prized heirloom of our family silver. I think that word with then speaks into our understanding that it should be about what we think about connection. But I just want to say about this about connection, because I wondered if I just asked you to say what you think about the connection. More than likely, some of the things that will come into our head are Methodist Church House, TMCP, assessment, etc., etc. Yeah, things beyond that. Then the connection has said. Which is just the wrong way around. And so what I came out of sabbatical more committed to, I think, than ever, was the notion of, I love connection,
but we've just got it completely the wrong way round. And we need to start from almost anything that we're thinking about connection, start from the grassroots and the local, and that expression of mission or witness or social outreach or whatever it is, that is expressing that DNA of Methodism. Start there and then think about connection. So we start there with our desire to encourage and pour fuel on the flames of what is happening locally in every little place, every big place, everywhere, and say, right, we're with you in that. How are we going to make you more successful, more effective, and all the rest of it? Yeah. And so the picture then is that we
have a connectionalism that creates diversity rather than uniformity. That's the goal. Connection isn't there to make everyone Methodist Magnolia. But it feels like that sometimes. I remember saying 20 odd
years ago in Barnsley, but then I looked at our circuit plan with then 30 churches. With 30 services, that they all started at 10:30, apart from Brian at 10:15 because they were radical. I said, but if you go to virtually any other of them, with hardly much difference, with not much variation, they'll all just about be doing the same linking thing. It's like a radio that you turn on, and wherever you are on the thing, it's always the same channel. And it's that kind of that we've ended up in this place of uniformity rather than diversity. So, I'm not going to take too long on this either, but a sense of connection
being that thing that enables us to be releasing waves of grace and growing through means of grace. This is just me in my head trying to redefine what I think connection is. So I want to say, I'll come back to it, it's all about grace. Creating opportunities for God's grace to change and form us. Call to love and praise said this in 1999, a statement that means we really mean it. In the New Testament, the understanding of the church's life and mission was derived from Jesus and developed in a rich variety of ways. This diversity is itself an important testimony to the multifaceted nature of the church. It does not, however, obscure the fundamental underlying unity. Absolutely. So we're not talking about creating this unity, but we're actually saying the connection is here to encourage huge diversity, which means that the smallest rural hamlet little chapel with no running water and all the rest of it, we're saying, how can we make you a place that's flourishing and all the rest of it, everything in between. And we need to be so careful that we're resisting that urge, which is just a natural institutional urge to plump for uniformity. This is how we do it. You know, and I hear all the grumbles, you know, that says it feels like what comes out from the connection, which we now know.
Not necessarily. It feels like it's not with us in mind. But we've got to change that around so that actually it always feels like it's with you in mind, because you're where it's really at. Not the 195 people that work at Marylebone Road, but with you. Okay. So, my dream of our
connection being really important, it's about with. No one's isolated. No one's on their own. No one's left to rack and ruin. The dream of our connection being custodian and an enduring reminder of our why. They're holding it together, that vision, everything we've got. A vast, I was struggling with images here, other people were better than that, a vast palette of contrasting shades. It's like, you know, the crown paint chart or whatever, and you've got everything, and you think, how do you come up with calling it that? And all the rest of it, I'm colourblind, so let me see. But all of that, you know, and then it feels like, sometimes it feels to me like we've got all of that, and then we do say, thanks for that, Methodist Magnolia. But actually, it's saying, here's the palette. And what colour is it going to be? Well, it's down to who's here on the ground, who knows that ground best, who can do it. Get on with it. So a vast palette of contrasting shades, a hugely diverse tapestry. As the people call Methodists, we don't need to be uniform. We don't all need to be the same. We don't all need to think the same. We're both and people. And God's grace is what's going to hold us together. So a fluid, flexible network of encouragement and support, a vibrant web of relationships which ensures that our charisms are fleshed out and enabled. Does this make sense? So we're pouring energy on the expressions of God's grace wherever they are. Now, I know sometimes it feels like that is a dream. But actually, I think, well, you know, I came back from sabbatical. And Charles said that's nice. Elaine Heath. This 2 punishing quotes coming on here, but I think they speak truth. It's imperative that the institutional church that's collapsing beneath bureaucratic top heaviness, clergy-centric practice, ecclesiastic loss of soul, how are you doing so far? Live forward into the original vision of Jesus. The purpose of remaining connected while modeling emergence Christianity is twofold. To ignite renewal within the declining church and to help the emerging communities, that's fresh expression stuff, remain accountable to the tradition behind the tradition, one of my favourite phrases, that the inherited church carried forward. In other words, blended ecology. You're holding it all together because of Rebecca. And Michael Beck again. Denominations have tried top-down leadership strategies to reverse decline for decades. Perhaps we need to give local grassroots revolutionaries a chance. We need cohorts of local church leaders who will dig into their context and resist the urge to climb the corporate ladders of denominational success. Now, he's an American Methodist, and it's worse over there. But nonetheless. Connection. Now, I'm in danger of becoming a bit more controversial. Set free in leadership and Methodism. Mission. What did I say? Sorry, mission. Sorry, yeah, thank you. I didn't mean it. Set free in leadership and mission. The rapid growth of early Methodism was stunning. And when you think about it, from naught to where they got to by the time Wesley died, with the halls.
It's pretty impressive going, isn't it? And it was a stunning combination of an openness to the Holy Spirit and that zealous commitment to preaching and living out the good news of the gospel. So they were back to seeking and sending and all that stuff. So all of that, but also, crucially, a creation of
structures that supported and accelerated the work of God. And that was, in a sense, that was one of Wesley's big things. You can't just go out, and he got really frustrated. He just went go out and preach, and everyone responded, and they go back, and they were all back to their old ways again. And he very quickly realized that was just, and he actually said even worse, he said, it's more harm than good, because once I've done that, they go away, they're even more in the hands of the devil than they were when I started. So that's why all this, you know, society, class, band, and all of that emerged, because he recognized that we needed structure. Grace needs to be responsibly handled. That's the way we handle it within the structures. We need to take responsibility for it. And so this was the genius. And what we saw, of course, was the recruitment and vitalization of local lay leadership. One of the key roles was the role of the class leader, as it was, that leader of the small group. It wasn't house group this Wednesday night, I haven't thought of anything to do yet, but we'll think something when we get there. It wasn't that. It was about a group
of people being together with a leader who was taking responsibility for responsible grace to develop. And for all that stuff we were thinking about sanctifying grace. And for then God's work to emerge out of those conversations. So what's God calling you to? You said that's a finding, forgiving, forming. How are we being formed? What's God got on your heart? What are you now being called to do, etc. So extraordinary recruitment of local lay leadership. And they reckon by the time Wesley died, 1 in 10 Methodists was a leader. From a standing start. And you would maybe not surprised to hear me say that I want to argue very, very strongly that this is our future. Yeah. The recruitment and revitalization of local lay leadership. Because that's where the action's at there, with those local people in that local context who are doing that amazing stuff. And that means
renewing our understanding of presbyterial ministry. For sake quick, and maybe get away with it. I think we've lost the thought.
Except that, of course, we were a movement within the Anglican Church, and the expectation was on a Sunday you go to the parish church and you have the means of grace.
Some of them
have means of grace there.
Now, as Methodism developed, and John Wesley's horse just would not go fast enough,
and so he couldn't keep an eye on all the things, because that's how he was, in a sense, that great oversight, very powerful oversight, and he would rush around and kick people out who would fall down and all the rest of it.
So he appointed assistants and helpers. Who were they?
They were the people who had already proven that they were really good class leaders. They were already doing good missional discipling stuff. They were the right, you've got the potential. Right, you can be an assistant or helper, local preacher, then becoming an itinerant. So it's a long and weaving story. But basically, our Methodist ministry emerged from that sense of being Wesley's arms and legs and eyes and ears out there on his behalf, because he was a bit of a control freak. But he was holding everything in connection. Okay?
And I think it's vital for us that we renew ourselves
because in this way, because actually I think it helps us to discover how we can do that blended ecology stuff again. Now, episcope, oversight, posh word for oversight, in one of our Methodist reports on it, I think it called it really helpfully, watching over in love, keeping an eye on what's happening. So it needs people who are seeing over what's going on. Now, in old Methodist money, class leaders offered that episcope, oversight, in every place and context. The class meeting being David Lowes Watson, being the sinew of early Methodism, he said. That's how it was. So those class leaders were offering oversight. It was not just oh, I've had a bad cold this week. It was spiritual discipling, missional leadership. Okay, but they were offering that local oversight. They were entrusted with it. It was their job. They were leaders. And as I say, the assistant and helpers provided episcopate to classes and societies as they were gradually set aside in itinerant circuit ministry. It took ages to end up where we are now. But do you see, so the local action at episcopate was happening at the grassroots, in the local, small local, and the what we now call ministers or presbyters, they were offering that oversight, which wasn't embedded deeply within what was happening at the local, but it was coming to give encouragement and oversight and challenge and all the rest of it. And then the conference, if you like, they all provide, once John Wesley finally died, the conference embodied John Wesley's sense of holding it all together across the connection, providing corporate episcopal oversight. Sorry, I slipped into some jargon here. But what we had here was within early Methodism was a liberty. Have I just gone back? No, I see what I'm doing. Sorry, it's because I've lost my notes. Yes. The cost of what we've lost, this is, I think, the cost of what we've lost, the absence of meaningful personal episcopate of local leadership, i.e. that type of local confident leadership, which is not, we'll have to wait for the minister, is the absence of effective and dynamic local episcopate which reaches and watches over every member and seeker. That's our DNA, local lay folk, equipped, released to be leaders. And then the set-apart episcopate of circuit presbyters, as we now call them, what's happened there is they're overtaken by an embedded focus and activity at the heart of local church life. What do I mean by that? Everyone wants to know who's in charge in your local church and who's going to be the minister. It seems. Well, that's and there's a collusion going on here, which is not Methodist. So that a presbyter's role is not to be in charge of your local church. The local church or your local mission activity, whatever, should be lay-led. And circuit presbyters, some of you will know this, circuit presbyters are stationed to a circuit, not a church, not churches. And yet we've ended up in this place where we call pastoral charge, where we think there's this. So we've ended up with this bickering model, which is not Methodist. And as I've said here, it's fatally debilitated the episcopacy of ministerial visitation, because every minister is too closely, in general, embedded within the local church situation, rather than being able to offer that slightly more oversight role that looks on and looks in and checks in and checks on all the rest, I think. The genius of indigenous local mission and discipleship held together in full connection as an effective movement is lost because the essential episcopate reach right into the grassroots is simply not there. Sorry, this is me writing rather than speaking something. But I just think we've ended up with the wrong model. And the really interesting thing is, but standing orders, the rule book, still primarily refer to lay and presbyteral roles in these distinctively Methodist ways. So actually, you can't form a new church unless you've got class leaders in place. Who knew? Presbyters are stationed to the circuit, not to the church. It doesn't talk anywhere in our rules about ministers having pastoral charge over particular churches. Some get very precious. Because it's not the Methodist model, and it never was, and it's part of why we've got a problem, I think. So getting moving again, you may have things to say to me in a few minutes, but I guess that's fine, or throw at me. Getting moving again, raising, this is absolute priority stuff, I think, raising up local indigenous leaders in mission and service, people on the ground who God's Spirit is doing stuff in, and they're transitioning from being sought by God to being sent by God, and we're saying, great, get on with it. How can we help you to be a leader in that place? Rediscovering the distinctive role of presbyteral ministry as a vital set-apart local translocal ministry. It just means within that locality of a circuit, they've got an overarching view of what's going on in the circuit. I have to tell you, I've had three conversations this week with ministers who said they're really struggling with their vocation because they don't feel they can hack pastoral charge as it is at the moment, because it just feels like a burden they can't carry. And then a creative weaving together of lay and ordained, and the indigenous, those people are rooted in the place and they're set apart, who can come and see the bigger view. We may want to come back to this. Okay. So, I'm getting to the business end now. I think this might be chapter 10. The people called Methodists, a diverse community of grace spaces. I'm dreaming here. I've not got this tied down. The sabbatical came to an end and I had to go to conference. But just this thought about grace spaces and rediscovering the key building block is not that, but it's actually grace spaces. It's about, and I'm just wanting to articulate and play with, and as I say, I'm on the edge now of where my head is, but I want to play with the notion of us understanding ourselves primarily as grace spaces, because the problem with the buildings is they end up defining so jolly much. And they give us an inheritance that we think we can't possibly drop. And we spend vast amounts of money and time and energy. And we sacrifice our best people on that altar. And our buildings, whilst they can be brilliant servants, are really poor masters. So I'm not saying sell all the buildings quite. Not yet. But I am saying, if we want to orientate and take our why seriously for a post-Christendom age, then I think we need to reorientate how we understand ourselves. And I'm making a plea that thinking about grace spaces might be a possible way forward. So what do I mean by that a little bit more? Well, think about what we said about grace: prevenient, justifying, sanctifying, finding, forgiving, forming. So for John Wesley, we summarize it as the fields. He went from pulpit to field, and literally fields, and tombs on which he stood and preached, and prisons into which he went, and social action campaigns in which he fought, and all the rest of it. But basically out there, he went out there. And why did he go out there? Because he wanted to help people latch on to the prevenient grace, that finding grace of God. This is one of our primary things, to be a people who are enabling people to be unlocked by God's grace. God will find them, but we can help. So being a people called Methodists who are committed to that type of activity, and some of them, many of you are, we do it all sorts of ways, and some of the stuff that we talked about, Action for Children, MHA, and all we can, are doing some of that and more. But that's one of our grace spaces. Creating spaces where we're creating room for God's grace to break through. Okay? And then what was called the society. Interesting, some of the reading I had, and I wasn't sure I went 100% on it, but I've just latched into it for now. The society, which was like the collection of classes together. Primarily, interestingly, at first, it was primarily for a good sing and some good testimony and a real celebration. And we desperately need that kind of thing. We need, I think, celebratory stuff. And it was a place then where people who maybe had been out in the field and said, well, come along to the society, they came and they were able to respond. To the they were able to make it their own, responding. So like in between the prevenient and the justified. So we need those places of grace where we're singing our hearts out and having a really good, and we've got decent coffee to follow, so it's all right. And we're hearing testimonies about what God's up to. And it's all got life and celebration because we're full of zeal as Methodists, yeah? And then we also need what John Wesley saw, the class, which was like the justifying place, maybe, and a bit more, but that place where things were being worked out with God. How is it with your soul? Things were being worked out with God. Who was leading it? The local pastor. Who was leading the society? The society stewards. Who were the society stewards? Class leaders who felt they got that they were mature enough to do that. And the band, which we haven't talked much about, but that smaller thing, which was never as it was like for those who really wanted to push forward, but that forming. So that's another great space. So where are we forming? One of the great things that happened for me over the last year is within Kairos, then one of the new circuit, one of the things we've done is we want to really push grassroots groups, which is effectively this stuff on that bottom of that diagram where we're saying we want to take seriously our journey together. And I have the privilege of just being for usually half an hour, just with two others, most weeks we can make it, in that kind of thing. And for me, there's always riches in that. Not because of what I give, but because of what I'm given. There's always riches for me, and there's more to do with that. But that sense of social holiness, helping our personal holiness. See how it's hanging together in this weird head I've got? Okay, so grace spaces, framed a bit like that. And then, to say this about how this is all organized, this is again controversial, I know. We've talked long and hard in all our Methodist paperwork over donkey's years about the circuit as the primary unit. It says it in standing order, so it's okay. Primary unit. And I just want to make an appeal, I think, at this point, that I think this should come of age again, really, seeing the circuit as the primary unit, which is both a safety net and a canopy that enables within it a vast array of lay-led grace spaces to happen. So forget being defined by your chapel building and that, but actually asking the question, so who's God raising up to lead something fresh? It could be social action, it could be. So it could be all of this, it could be anything. It could be a new form of worship, it could be anything. Okay? But it doesn't have to go through, or it doesn't have to fit. The aim is not so that when you've done some of them, they come along at 10:30 to the building. It's a grace space. It's a space for God's grace. But then it's only part of the jigsaw. And you see your ministers as a resource for the whole circuit. What would that be like? If actually things were defined in a new way, so that the ministers within your circuit team, with their gifts and graces, were able to be a team that was operating around the circuit, offering for each local grace space what they need. What can encourage them the most. And the priority, I think the priority that we have is equipping and releasing leaders. By the time Wesley died, 1 in 10 Methodists were leaders. I think we've got a dreadful issue about leadership and thinking it through carefully and releasing and equipping leaders so that they feel completely embodied as a leader, not just doing something until someone with a dog collar comes around or whatever it is, but actually equipping and releasing leaders. So we're nearly there. So I'm not really good at graphics on PowerPoint, so this is a bit limited. Sorry. Andy, you could have done this a lot better. So here's a circuit. I've deliberately not talked about that governance support, but it needs dealing with. And when I was at a meeting that Graham was at the other week, he said, well, one of the things that's different now from the 18th century, we've got all this governance stuff. Do you know what I'm saying, that, Graham? And you're absolutely right, and it absolutely needs nailing. But if we don't nail it, it will nail us. And so we need to be hugely more imaginative than we have been, I think, about saying governance. We're gonna look after governance in a professional way, which means there are people who know what they're doing and equipped and paid as they need to be doing to make sure all that governance stuff, which is really, really important, and we need to do it really, really well, is sorted out. And the circuit does that for that whole parish of the circuit, whatever that looks like. The circuit does it. The circuit will sort it. And when you're doing your little wonderful grace space, which is the heartbeat of the connection, it's fine because the governance will be sorted out. There's a lot of stuff to work in detail between me saying that and doing it. But that's what we've got to do. And then, as I said, ministerial oversight of the circuit. So do you need a new minister? Well, it's not because you've just got a gap in X, Y, and Z church, but actually it's a question about what does the circuit need. And what ministry would you be? And so when you write your profile, it's not because you've got that gap there, but it's we need these gifts in a presbyter now for our circuit to be able to share around. And also the circuit there, making real our connection, that it is about the widths, identifying everything as a width, connected grace spaces. And the circuit also then taking a lead on equipping the saints because of the ministerial oversight, which is encouraging people to be released, etc., etc. I'm just going to say some things that just sort of reiterate a bit of what I've said. So what does that look like? Well, it looks like loads of grace spaces where the waves of grace, that stuff that's about prevenient grace and justifying grace and sanctifying grace, those things are happening in all sorts of different ways, huge diversity, crown, paint, chart, all sorts of ways. And also the means of grace are being provided. So, you know, you don't... It means that inherited and fresh expressions are sitting together. And we're glad for each, and as we said before, one's informing the new, and we're, and I've put this fertile ground in the middle, because I think between both these, both hands, is fertile ground of mixing. Vintage wine in old wineskins, and new wine in new wineskins, we're allowing everything to find its home. So if, you know, if you've got a really good, solid, inherited church model that's working reasonably, really well, let's make it the best we can. Let's ask of it, how can it be better? How can it be better at its worship and all the rest of it? But if we've got new wine, don't just encumber it with some old stuff, but let it be free. New grace space. Rooted in our understanding of God in Scripture, there's a place for the temple and the tabernacle. The temple was the place where everyone went, so it's great to have some, it is good to have some buildings where people can gather to celebrate and all the rest of it. But also the journey with God was also about tabernacles, where you just carry it along with you. So we shouldn't be defined by our... No, we really, really shouldn't be defined by our buildings. Please call that God. Jerusalem, Antioch. Jerusalem, the stable, this is where God's action is. But also Antioch, where the Christians went. Is it Acts 15? Is that where they were first called Christians? So the centre and the margin. But they're both part of it. And in a sense, they're equal players. I talked earlier on about being equally valued, equal players within it all. Because they both count just the most. Host and guest. An interesting balance between being maybe a building with a fine set of premises like these is a dilemma. And people coming here, and we're the host, welcome. But also going to those places where we're the guest, and we're having to talk on different terms. But they're living together. Online and on-site. That's a huge difference from the 18th century, isn't it? But online and on-site, that we're valuing those equally, that we're seeing them both as grace spaces. Extraordinary what's happened online, not just because it had to happen. Whether you're a fan or not of Alpha, I mean, the Nicky Gumbel story about Alpha is he never thought it would work online, and now he'll never let it go. Because it's just been extraordinary how it's been powerful online. And people have been sat in a lounge, logged on to Alpha, and he's prayed, come Holy Spirit, come. And they said, I couldn't believe it. Gathered, attractional, scattered, distributed, a bit similar to the host. Yes, you know, so there is still a place for that model that says we're here at 10:30 on Sunday, come and join us. But do you see, we need all of that other stuff as well. Grace spaces, spaces for people to grow in grace, to discover grace. So here we are. The circuit, these are grace spaces. This is as technical as I can get on a PowerPoint. My vision is just this extraordinary diverse array of people doing all kinds of things because of grace. Sharing grace, helping people to grow in grace, helping people to discover what it is that God's calling them to be. If there's one element of grace that's more important than the other, I think that band meeting type thing is probably the most important thing, that every Methodist should be part of a small group, part of their life, which is about social holiness, doing it together, as we're committed to as Methodist members. What I would have done if I just ran out of time, actually, I think I could have worked out to do this. I would have had these coming and then going. Because the other thing I want to say is that nothing needs to last forever. And a grace space can start and develop and blossom and bloom, and it can be wonderful. So you run an alpha course for a while, and then a group forms, but things happen and it moves on, and it's time to stop. And we've got a dreadful habit and pattern, haven't we, in the church of thinking we must just keep it going. Long, you know, and keep it going. Oxygen, more oxygen, come on. And it died 5 months ago. We need to get much better. You see, and I just think this model offers us a chance for that. But we don't, because what hinders us sometimes is the building. We've just got to keep the building going. But But grace spaces, they come, they go. But the important thing is that people are finding the next place for grace. So it's not come and gone and we've lost sight of it. You know, the genius of Wesley, remember? He knew how to get things in order, so there was structure there. So we don't let people go because they're within a circuit of held together. So here we are. Two slides to go. There's my chapters. Confident of our why. On fire with the gospel, captivated by grace, both and people, renewing the church, giving ourselves away with godly zeal, set free in leadership and mission, united with through connection, and thereby a diverse community of grace spaces. When I did all my writing, I didn't note down who wrote this, so I'm just going to claim it for myself, but it's too good for me to have written. Our divinely appointed mission is nothing less than to look for God's gracious work in our own lives, being tuned by our fellowship, then inevitably and purposefully spilling out and effecting the transformation of homes, schools, workplaces, communities, national politics, and so on. There is nowhere in the parish of the world where the people called Methodists are not called to be salt and light. We're called to be change makers. So that's where I got to by the 23rd of June or whatever, at this conference then. You've been more than reasonably patient
with me, and I'm really pleased that I managed to stick to the hope that we could have some time for conversation. So what I suggest is, just to get that going, you maybe just have a chat with someone next to you or with yourself, just to reflect on this, maybe, you know, the stuff that you really want to take issue with, or it's that took a, you didn't understand, whatever, and then we'll just have a conversation for a while. Is that okay? Great, thank you very much. Have 5 minutes or something.
Shall we come back together again? And
we can hear different voices then. Thank you. I meant earlier on, can I say a huge thanks to Bev and Tibby who provided coffee and biscuits and mince pie. Thank you. And also to Steve, who's worked really hard on all the technical stuff, and would we know it would be live streaming, so there we are. So one man and his dog have been watching. So there we are. So thank you, Steve, for all your input there. That's great.
I was sat there watching your model and your dots coming on and thinking, I can shoot this down in a minute, but then you just completely disarmed me by saying, I'd like those things to fade. And I think the one of the issues we have is actually getting people to accept that their little dot needs to fade and there's something beyond it. Part of the good news of the gospel is that after death comes resurrection. And maybe we're not getting that message through, actually, there is something beyond where we are now. And I think that's the real difficulty, is that it's great when we sat here, probably with a lot of reasonably like-minded people. I'm not saying that as disparagingly, because we're the enthusiasts and people who want to do this, but how do we get that excitement? That's the real tricky bit as far as to get that excitement into the body of the church and get people to say, yeah, let's do something different. So I've got no answer, just an observation.
Thank you. It's rock hard. And anything I'm going to say now is going to rapidly oversimplify what is exactly, as you said, a really difficult issue, I think. I think in terms of how do we get new things go, it's all about
looking for what God is doing in my life, your life, other people's lives, and enabling and releasing that. So, you know, that's the model, trying to find ways in which we equip and enable people who want to do new things. In terms of things that need to die, I think it's really hard, but I just think we need to stop offering life support. That's not easily said, but I think we're going to have to stop offering life support. If local... There's a caveat around governance, because governance is just something that needs to be handled elsewhere. But if local folk have lost their vision and heart and soul for what's happening in that local expression and mission, we need to allow it to die, and we need to help it die, I think.
Sorry, that's a bit radical, painful, because there's a lot of pain in saying that. That's what I think. Heather?
So what light and what grace spaces can you see developing in the district, Leslie, at the moment that would really let us end maybe this morning with some real encouragement? Where is lay leadership growing? What grace spaces are developing?
Andy
and Anne would be really well placed to answer some of that question, because they've been working for a while, so they're pioneers around the district. I feel like I'm in props committee now. I think where I see expressions of people excited, people coming together, one or two people, always more than one, please, coming together to do something new, there's a real hope of God in that. So there's people coming together because they're on the social action side of things, people are coming together because they want to make a difference about homelessness, people are, for instance, people in Hall at Open Doors, that's been going for yonks, but that's an extraordinary project of being there and offering grace to people from all sorts of ways. A much smaller example in Hall is Selby Street, the other part of that, whereas you just said to me yesterday in a phone call, didn't you, go there and that's where God's at. But actually, it looks like it's, it's a fairly decrepit building. That's a bit cruel. No, the district spent quite a bit of money on it, actually. Yeah, okay. formal integration. I've not been since it's been. But it's in a community that where there's all sorts of different needs, and yet those folk with those different needs, sorry, sloppy language, are, it seems to me, at the heart of what of that Christian community. They're not being served; they are part of that community. Is that a fair comment, Leanne?
I think a lot of the encouraging signs of where God is at work and where new things are growing are where people with no experience of church are feeling that they can take a lead, and because they don't realise they can't. And so it's encouraging that, and letting us go with what God is doing through those other people.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, us not having to own it all.
A church that says after years it'd be really great to have a church weekend, that'd be a place of grace. That'd be a place of grace. Folk who just want to explore a different. So you wanted specific examples, weren't you? It's happening all over in all sorts of different ways. Tom, have we got anyone from North Yorkshire Coast? Tom, up there doing
amazing work on two of the more needy estates. Where he's helping folk there. He's a leader, and he's helping folk there to lead through breakfast bags and provision of stuff for the needy families, but also then being able to facilitate new work amongst that. Appleton Whisk, small church, northern end of our district. I think it's an amazing place. Appleton Whisk. God is really there. Small little chapel, 250 years old.
But actually, fresh as a daisy, is that the expression? Because there's a fantastic leader there called Karen, who's just incredibly mobilising and pioneering within that small community. And when you go and be part of worship there, it's fresh and vibrant, and it feels like this is a space of grace.
Some of the digital stuff, I think, is offering us adventures in spaces of grace where there's new things happening. I could genuinely go on, but I'd love to see loads more. One of the things I've talked about with Victoria, our youth workers, is wouldn't it be great if the Methodist Church, whatever we mean by that, the Methodist Church was that place, that people, where people out there who thought, I really want to change the world, where should I go? Oh, I'll go to the Methodist Church. And people would say, I really want to know more about God. Where did he go? The Methodist Church. Because we'll help. Grace spaces is the answer, not a menu on 10:30 or something. Which can be great.
Thank you, Leslie. I wonder if you have any thought about size of church. Because it seems to me that a lot of what we've been talking about this morning is easier to do with a small chapel, 20 people. When you get 200, you've got problems.
Well, you've got different. You've got fresh opportunities as well. I did give some thought, and I actually cut the slides down because I was just going to yatter on too long. So when the bubble that I had with circuit.
I think I was using circuit as being that. Enough capacity there in terms of thinking about a circuit to be able to say, so we'll be able to sort out that governance, to be able to create a place where there's all those mixes of race spaces, and that can happen. But I also think, I do think there's a place for a larger local church to in effect take the place of a circuit, and then be in itself enabling loads of race spaces to happen. So to personalise the gracious street. large church, nearly 200 members, great suite of premises. I think that could have legs to do all of that stuff. So long as the goal is not so that we can make our Sunday morning, I'm not saying the goal is Sunday morning at 10:30 to be as big a jamboree every week as possible, but actually it's got the capacity and the space to be able to offer great spaces and to be able to do moving out. So before I came to York, I was looking after Bramble, which had in Stockport, which is a peculiar place in the suburbs of Manchester. Manchester, but he had over 400 members there. And one of my great regrets there is that I didn't push the church hard enough in diversifying. And now, if I had my time again, I would. And I would still want the big gatherings where we all came together, but not to make that so much of the deal. Yeah, the old second rally. Yeah. Yes, absolutely.
I say that we have the opposite. I was thinking exactly the opposite of that question, which is a big church of 200, grace spaces sounds really easy because you've got 200 people with 200 sets of gifts that you can put out into the community to make grace spaces. We've got a church with seven. And we're the youngest in that church by a long way. So trying to get grace spaces out, we'd be sort of trying to think now, how do we do that in our small village, which is separated, you know, we're in the Goole and Selby circuit, so all our villages are quite, you know, separated from quite a bit. People don't move. So if we close our church in East Grington, nobody from that church is going to go into Goole because they're too old, and then we've lost a central place. So how do we manage to do grace spaces with small numbers in large, you know, the district is big, isn't it? How do we do that is a question.
You're more the majority than Brian.
What's God doing in your hearts? That's a rhetorical question. What's God up to? I'm not into your content. I've watched your YouTube. It's good. Well done. You did a lot through lockdown, didn't you? Well done. Yeah, well done. No, fantastic for doing it. What is God up to for you? What is unlikely to be up to, please don't take any offence, is just keeping something going on life support. And I'm not talking to you because I don't know your context. You know, he's not into that, he's into letting things die so that new life can come. So find what God's wanting you to do, which may not look like anything that your church currently does or ever has done. It may be that what I'm saying is actually your church may close. You've already said to me, that means they put those folks, won't go anywhere. No.
The sad bit about
sad.
About the grace that we're talking about is that that closes, and then how do they access as a community, because we, you know, the East Riding is very less than 1% claim Christianity, yeah. I think. How do we then get to those people? I suppose it's coming from the centre, isn't it? That's what from district and but having a vision that comes out, because if you've got nobody in the community, how do you then do it?
If you've got nobody in which community?
In those little communities that are all isolated little communities.
You've got you. Sorry, what's the grace space that you can offer?
We've got lots of grace spaces.
I know.
We've been thinking of, but I'm thinking of the other communities that have nobody in there, and then you sort of. Whereas what I thought was really good about your picture was those circles were popping up, and what I hoped, not that they'd vanish necessarily, though that's really good as well, was that they coalesced so that the whole lot became blue, uh-huh. You know, dark blue. That would have been fantastic. That would have liked.
Yeah, okay.
That.
I hear that. I hear that. But Methodism Year Zero, we had no one anywhere, and we need to be prepared to die a whole lot more than we've been prepared to die so far, and that's really horrible. So it means that do we mean we're out of a community yet? So church, sorry, we'll come on to it
then. Church I worked was served in Barnsley at Pogmoor. Was just having their closing service on the 19th of December. They're closing their chapel. They've just moved into the pub. And are they doing everything they used to do? No, but actually they're absolutely flying in the pub, and who'd have thought it? And they're now saying they're creating a whole new story which goes along the lines of, gosh, we just realised that everybody could see us now. And they're actually growing. So I know that's a very poor example answer to you as well, but my harder answer is we need to let things die. Sorry, if there's no local leaders, then that means that God's not speaking to those leaders to lead, so we need to let it die. Ruth.
A couple of things. One, just an observation that a church of 200 doesn't necessarily have the leaders for the grace spaces, because it can be a place where lots of people can hide.
Yes.
And and therefore not become leaders.
Yeah.
And it can sometimes be even more difficult to develop those grace spaces, because there's so much that is fixed and so many people who feel that it's fixed. So that's just an observation. The other thing I was going to say is that we one of the things that I talked about for lots of times, and I know that Ben and I had talked about, was how we got people praying more before lockdown. And during lockdown, we started doing morning prayers on Facebook Live at 8 o'clock every morning using the Methodist worship book. Who would have thought that all these weeks and months later, there is a group of about 20 of us who meet regularly every weekday morning at 8 o'clock online for prayers. And some of us have actually met for the first time today, right, ever. And we're going to have coffee together. We're actually going to meet face to face and have coffee. But we have this group who are praying for the church, for the world, for other people, for grace spaces. And that is actually a real place for grace. You might find that if your little chapel closes and disappears, then there's a space for grace either online or in somebody's living room with a coffee morning where they talk. We had a do you remember the Bible Fresh thing? We had a coffee fresh on a Saturday morning where people just came along having read the Bible passage. They hadn't had to do any Bible study, they hadn't had to do anything before it, but they just came having read that passage and we discussed it, what thoughts they'd had about it. 45 minutes on a Saturday morning, and that was a grace space.
Yes, thank you, Helen. Thanks, Ruth. Thank you for sharing that. Yeah, grace space. So that online prayer is, isn't it?
Yeah. There's a couple of reflections, really. One, just to uphold all that you shared this morning, and just to echo back, just a few weeks ago, I was reading the calling of the first disciples and was drawn to those who were mending the nets. I really do feel that we have to mend our nets if we are going to energize the church in mission. We need to be prepared to hold those who we receive. And how do we do that? Reflecting back, just the energy of the initial movement of Methodism, was societies of those were energized to move, to be in a movement that was not standing still. And I do agree with you that we, you know, to revitalize that calling of the Methodist people is really important, and how we structure ourselves in leadership and how we equip and resource those who have the gifts and graces and skills in leadership. But I think we also need to be reminded that we are also church, and that we have taken on board the responsibility of being a sacramental presence. Mm-hmm. That is in partnership, in complete symbiosis with a missional presence. And sometimes, you know, I'm listening to those of you who are very small in very distant communities. If you were to die, then you lose a sacramental presence where there is something of the attractional, where people do still go for their rites of passage. And I think it's a very difficult tension that we're called to hold, because we have taken on the responsibility of being church and a recognisable, visible presence, as well as a missional movement that is beyond the walls. And I'm speaking as someone who's been involved in Fresh Expressions and is, you know, it's still, my heart is for mission outside the walls of church. But I just, in the context of conversation that we've had today, I just think we also need to hold the two spaces that we are obliged to fill.
Yeah, I agree. I agree to the extent. I think it's part of our both and, that we are both. And I think that was on the slide.
Yeah.
But what is almost dead must be allowed to die.
Just following on really from the both and in another scenario. So the two things, I loved all of it, but the both and the set free and leadership and mission kind of sit together in a way. Just talking here with my neighbour, that's in my church, 90% of people want 10:30 a.m. Sunday morning worship, as it's always been, but they're quite glad about some of the things that we've introduced in the last 18 months, some different kind of music, and you know, it's good, it's all good, but they want, that's what they want. They also want the church to grow, they want it to be more visible, they want the community outreach, but you know, I'm one of the youngest people there, I work full time, I'm a local preacher, they want me to preach, you know. It is wanting the cake and eating it.
Yeah.
And for 15 years, I feel like I've been preaching for longer than that, but it feels like trying to do the best of what's possible in, you know, within my responsibility there and what God's called me to do there and in my day job. And I don't feel set free by any of that. And I think, you know, I'm seeing, as I'm reflecting on growing older, I'm just thinking of the time that is slipping away and the opportunity to do something about that.
Yeah. And there's many people like you, and I'm probably going to misstate your story now, so depersonalizing it from you, Rachel, sorry. But I think, you know, people who feel that they owe a debt to keep things going for other folk is honorable. And if I pulled out now, then that would be really difficult for that community. But actually, I think that's probably the wrong question. The question has to be, you know, so what is God calling you to do? And if that means that you do need to step away, and that means that some of those other folk who are precious don't get what they would wish, well, God will have to sort that out another way.
But in order to do what I think God might be calling
me, well, I'm excited
do,
now.
I need the support of my church. I need them to be a praying community. I need them to...
You'll need support. You absolutely, social illness and all the rest of you, you'll need some support. You might not get everyone to support you.
Mm.
And some people will not understand it, but let's have a conversation, or have a conversation with someone about that though, Rachel. Yeah. Peter.
Thank you. Two comments. First, a societal understanding that the vast majority of our nation don't know the Christian story.
Indeed.
We're back into basic evangelism in the way that we were back in the day of St. Cuthbert and Aidan and Iona and all that, and also as we were in the days of Wesley.
Yep.
So we must never assume that people understand the Christian story. We have to tell the story. Don't care how we do it, we've got to tell the story and keep telling the story. That's the first comment.
Yeah.
Second one. Todmorden Edge Farm, high on the hills above Todmorden, was where the first circuit meeting in Methodism was ever held. It's a bleak place, and Methodists walked, or people who were following walked, for many, many miles to get to it. But that reminds us that much of the vibrancy of early Methodism was in homes, in houses, in farmhouses, in hamlets, in very humble homes often. So we can have fellowship and community that isn't necessarily in an ecclesiastical building, but it is in a building where people can flourish and be together.
Yeah, agreed. Thank you, Peter. Yeah. Yeah. Just maybe a couple more and then we'll call it a day, shall we?
Yeah, I'd like to say thank you. It's been quite a privilege to have a glimpse into your mind and possibly your heart. Thank you. I'm tempted to say it's been an inspirational morning, but can you tell us a butt coming?
What?
A butt.
Okay, there you go.
And the butt is that having read the result of Sangster's sabbatical that was published in 1938, I've read his diagnosis and his prescription for change. And I wonder, therefore, after another nearly 100 years of decline, what makes you think 2021 might be a more effective year for change than 1938?
That's a really good question. I think a big part of my answer, just very briefly, would be, are we more ready to die now than we were then? And in some places, we are more ready to die now than we were then. I think, and because it's more obvious that we are dying. And I'm not scared of that. I'm really not scared of that, because I also see all the places where life is and grass is growing through the cracks in the concrete and all the rest of it. You know, I think there's, so it's smaller, yeah. Having to pull out of communities where we've had a presence, yeah. But what's God doing in people's lives to reignite new stuff?
So, That's my only hope, and I don't know if I'm convinced by it. I don't think we are ready enough to die yet, but it won't happen until we are. I think.
Can I share something?
Yes, go on.
I just feel my heart warmed by the response. I feel my heart aching for those people who are saying, "I've got a call, but I can't do it where I am." I'm really thankful for my neighbour who said, "Isn't this what you're doing with Kairos? Trying to make these grace spaces." I think I'm hoping we're offering a both and to Methodists with Kairos, that you might be able to, you can be part of your current chapel and church and support it and be alongside it, but I hope we can also maybe link you in with another community, another group of people who will help you develop your heart and your calling. And maybe pursue a little bit of what you think God's giving to you. We are largely online, but we do meet occasionally. We're going to meet this afternoon. So when we end up somewhere, we try and invite people to gather with us. So I'm hoping we're a both and, as well as doing something fresh. It's a bit of a tension for us in our being, that the both and is difficult. And we want to be there for those people, as Peter said, who've not heard the gospel, who don't know you can't do stuff, because it's easy with them. Because they just do it. I'm going to do this. And they don't even ask permission. They're just doing it. And you go, okay, well, let me see if I can put some stuff around to help you do that. The Methodists kind of have to be persuaded to do stuff, even though they were wanting to do stuff. But so we wrestle with the same tension Wesley did. But it is what we're trying to do. And we are finding our way. So thank you for those who kind of made those links. It's encouraging. It took Wesley 3 hours to explain what Kairos is about, which is why when we stood up and shared, people are like, "Oh, what are you doing? I'm not quite sure." It is grace spaces. That's a really good summation, I think, in some ways. But so, just for my penneth. If you want to talk to us about it, if you think we might be able to help you, chat to Leanne and I, or some of the others who are here, who are already part of our little network of people trying to make it a reality. But it's not. We're not the only ones doing it. It's not just Kairos. There's all sorts of things happening within inherited church, isn't there?
There is. So
I don't want to claim that, but maybe we can help you.
Good plug. Yeah, thank you. Yeah. Shall we call it a day?
I was going to suggest that we might just sing the first song at the end. Would that be all right? So thank you. I hope that's not too indulgent. But it's the words are just fantastic. Why do we not sing this week's words?
But thank you so much for coming. Thank you so much for having to sit and listen for so long. I couldn't find another way to do it, and apologies for that. But thank you so much. I will, if people would like the PowerPoint pack, then I'll distribute that. I think I can do that through the Eventbrite that you booked on, so I'll try. I'll try and give you that if you want it. Thank you. And that's where I'm at. That's where I'm at. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God.